Hello, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Childhood Onset of Bipolar Disorders. I'm honored to introduce Dr. Robert Post, a member of IBPF's Scientific Advisory Board. Dr. Post worked for the National Institute of Mental Health for 36 years and is an editor of a free newsletter available at www.bipolarnews.org. Thank you so much, Dr. Post, for being with us.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for joining in on this. It's an important topic. And as you'll see from my talk, the name of the game is education and learning about this illness and how to manage it better. So we're going to try to emphasize that theme throughout. So, there we go. A few conflicts of interest that I don't think will be too relevant. We have this bipolar collaborative network, an international group of investigators with 4 sites in the US and 3 sites in the Europe, where we've studied about 956 outpatients, rated daily for many years. And what we found out was kind of a bit horrifying in terms of the severity of illness in the United States. Here is more problematic in every single which way. So if you look here in red at the genetic risk, our patients have parents with more illness, their grandparents with more illness, their siblings and spouses have more illness. We manage to marry other people with mood disorders more often than in Europe, and more offspring illness. So this kind of baseline risk is increased in the US. And then we have disappointingly more environmental adversity, childhood adversity, loss of social support, financial problems, healthcare access. And all of this goes into more illness, more episodes, anxiety, substance abuse. And with all of those things in the United States, we have fewer long-term responders to naturalistic treatment. So we need to do something about this. And basically the answer is to get after this illness earlier and better, right from the get-go, because we have all of these big boxes here: stress, sensitization, episodes, drug abuse. And what we say sensitization, meaning that if you have a stress earlier in life, you're more sensitive to stresses later in life that can trigger the onset of illness. And the more episodes you have, the faster they come. If you have something like cocaine abuse, it gets worse with each repetition. And all of these things interact to give you more severe illness in the United States. So just another verbal way of saying that stresses, mood episodes, and bouts of substance use accumulate. And on repetition, they show increased behavioral reactivity and cross-sensitization to the other ones. And this sensitization is mediated by long-term memory effects that affects your genes, not your inherited genes, but little pieces of chemicals that get on your genes and make them easier to turn on or off. And those marks make for the illness going downhill. So this is a schema that we illustrated, that basically on the left side, if you have early adversity in your life, that sensitizes you to later stresses in adulthood, then can trigger episodes. And those stresses leave behind chemical marks in your DNA. And the more depressions you have, the faster they come. Cocaine gets worse. So you end up having a whole lot of trait vulnerability at the end and the right there. However much you got from heredity is constant, but then you have increased vulnerability from stressors, episodes, and substance use. And it's a little bit like cancer. If you get rid of it early, you can get rid of it pretty well. And cancer has all of these somatic mutations that make it get worse over time if it's left alone. And we have these epimutations, if you will, little chemicals on our DNA, on our histones that the DNA is wrapped around, or the RNA, and that drives illness progression. So just like in cancer, we need early recognition and early treatment to get rid of it. So we want to do everything we can to avoid illness progression to treatment resistance. And some of the things we need to think about are even primary prevention in those at highest risk. We need to treat the early prodromes, the early symptoms. And then this new thing is not widely known, but I'm going to suggest that after a first mania, it's absolutely key to not have more episodes, because a first mania will mess up your cognition otherwise. So we want to prevent recurrence and progression. We also want to treat the high incidence of anxiety and substance abuse comorbidities that come with this illness. And if we don't get after it early and well, we can always get after it better later, but it often takes multiple kinds of different treatments aimed at different mechanisms of action. So early aggressive prevention and then later aggressive treatment if needed. So here's the story with childhood onset bipolar illness. It's really quite striking. And it's not only our data in the Bipolar Collaborative Network, where we saw 2/3 of the onsets before age 19, compared to just 1/3 in Germany and Netherlands. All the other folks, including the NIMH Step BD, had the same kind of early onset in the US. And it's actually striking because both our study and the PERLA study had about 1/4 of the illness starting before age 13. So this is a disorder of child and adolescent onset, and much more so in this regard than in some of the European countries. And that's a double whammy, because if you have early onset illness, it's a risk factor for a poor outcome in adulthood on its own, but it's also contaminated by a delay to first treatment, which is longer in the early onset patients. And the duration of the delay we found in our network was related to the severity of depression that somebody has as an adult. So another reason to get after this illness well and early, because if you don't, in the US, you end up with more adversity of illness. Anxiety disorder comorbidity in almost 1/2 our patients compared to 1/4 in Europe. And if you have anxiety disorder comorbidity, it's tougher to treat. If you have substance abuse comorbidity, it's tougher to treat. If you have very rapid cycling, which we found in 3/4 of our patients, it's tougher to treat. And interestingly enough, we had fewer hospitalizations despite this worse illness. And we had over 1/2 of our patients didn't have a good response when we treated them naturalistically and tried to get them better for at least 6 months. So tough illness in the United States. And our patients had offspring who had more illness in the offspring, not just bipolar illness in 15-20% of the patients, but more unipolar depression, more substance abuse in these kids, and this other is a lot of anxiety comorbidity. So about 1/3 of the offspring of our parents had some sort of major psychiatric diagnosis compared to low levels in Europe. And then it turned out when you look at grandparents and parents of our bipolar patients, we had more of everything in the US, more depression, more bipolar, more alcohol abuse, more substance abuse, and more other illness. And that family burden bred true into the offspring and even into the patient's siblings. So this illness burden is a big time explanation of the early onset story. So I'll take you through this slide a little bit, make it easy here. If you don't have family burden and you don't have childhood adversity, your average age of onset in about 100 people in this box is 26, which is the typical age that everybody used to talk about in the mid 20s. But look up here in the red boxes are people to the right who've had more childhood adversity, and if they've had that and more total family genetic vulnerability, their ages of onset in a much smaller group, but still their ages of onset tended to average under 13. So this in the US explains some of the issues. There are a lot of other variables, but more genetic vulnerability and more psychosocial adversity are two of the main ones. And actually our data probably an underestimate, because in the Pittsburgh study, they did more careful follow-up interviews for 7 years, and they found that 3/4 of the offspring of a bipolar parent had some kind of major diagnosis. Depression, anxiety, all sorts of other things. But the bottom here is quite striking. They had controls who didn't have a bipolar parent, and almost 50% of the controls had kids with a major psychiatric diagnosis. So US patients with bipolar disorder and their kids look like they're sicker than the Europeans. We have more illness. However, it's not just the kids with psychiatric illness. This guy Banks in the Journal of Medical Association wrote that Americans 55 years old and up, white males, are much sicker medically than the English, having everything, diabetes, hypertension, heart attacks, lung disease, cancer, and a whole bunch of other things. And they ruled out all sorts of things like treatment access and stuff like that. So it was pretty definite finding. And our provisional data looks like we have 3 or 4 generations in the United States that are more psychiatrically ill. So how do we address this issue of what's really an epidemic of childhood onset bipolar disorder in the US? We can ignore the data, which a lot of our friends like to do, and say there's other reasons, or we can actively address the problem, and we need to generate more treatment studies because there's a dearth of studies of how to treat childhood onset bipolar illness. And we need to build on what works for an individual, study early intervention, and we're trying to develop a practical clinical trials network to figure out what works best. But there's really not that much data. And here's just another way of schematizing all this. Here are the stages of illness progression from vulnerability to pre-symptomatic to a prodrome, a syndrome, recurrence, progression, and then treatment resistance. And usually in adults, we end up treating the illness here in the middle as things have already gotten pretty rough. And what we need to do is go back and start treating early, even in the prodrome or in the first syndromes, to prevent this progression to more treatment resistance. Because if you have more episodes of rapid cycling, you're going to do less well with almost all these treatments. Almost everything. Naturalistic treatment, mood stabilizers, atypicals, benzodiazepines, and even Jan Scott has cognitive behavior, psychotherapy doing less well in the people who have had more episodes. So it's tougher to treat after too many episodes. So what we want to do is get after all the things that progress and push the illness onward adversely. And here you can see psychoeducation is the name of the game in every aspect. But stress sensitization, substance abuse, and episodes, those are things that you can do something about to try to minimize or avoid, as opposed to the genetics that we can't do anything about at the moment. So psychoeducation, social support, psychotherapy, family, stress coping, key. Substance abuse sensitization. If you can try to get a patient who has early onset bipolar illness, they're 7 times more likely to adopt marijuana and other substances even more. So if you can help them with primary prevention, you're going to be doing a great thing. And then I'll show you some other things for tertiary prevention. Even after somebody started abusing substances, there's all kinds of things that we can do to help them get through that. And then this episode sensitization is the main thing. Starting prevention early and trying to head off as many episodes as one can. So these are the things that leave the epigenetic marks, but those can be reduced. And even getting after a parent's depression can result in the kids doing much better in the long term. So that puts us in the state where we need to get everybody in on this story, and not just for bipolar illness, but there's an even higher incidence of anxiety and depression and externalizing disorders. So looking out for these kiddie illnesses, pediatricians need to do it, because the pediatricians are the ones who see the most psychiatric illness in the United States. And Sokoff and Garner say that pediatricians need to be the guardians of people's mental health as well as physical health. We need to push them to do that. And then us adult psychiatrists need to ask about the health of our kids, our patients' children. And if they're having trouble, suggest that they get a good evaluation. And then many parents with this illness have joined in on this talk, and you can take a proactive stance and assist clinicians in the evaluation of your child. If you sign up on bipolarnews.org and hit on Child Network, you can get a readout of how the kid's doing with weekly ratings. I'll show you that in a minute. But here's part of the problem, that bipolar disorder in young kids is highly comorbid with ADHD. And if you look at all the ADHD things here on the right, attention, hyperactivity, impulsivity, racing thoughts, decrease, you can't figure out who's going to be bipolar and who's going to just be pure ADHD. So with Bob Finling, we had parents of kids who had clear-cut bipolar and clear-cut only ADHD rate their kids backwards every year of life. And we found out that the first things that started to differentiate these kids very well were brief and also extended periods of mood elevation, telling jokes in church, doing all kinds of things like that. Decreased need for sleep was a big one. And then if they had irritability and poor frustration tolerance, it was much more violent. So those were differences that could be seen even in a 3, 4, 5 year old who was going to become one or the other. And then later on, if somebody had periods of sadness, suicidal thinking, physical complaints and inappropriate sexual behavior in an pre-adolescent is often a tip off, because that doesn't happen in ADHD. So if the child has these things, which do distinguish bipolar from ADHD, that patient needs to be mood stabilized first. And then if they have a little residual ADHD, then he can come in and treat with low dose stimulants. But the problem is that the stimulants are being used first. There's 20 FDA approved stimulants for ADHD, and few, if anything, lithium and a few others for kids, young kids, 10 years old. So what happens? So stimulants and antidepressants are used more, and they either don't work very well or can mess things up further. And this kind of thing happens across the spectrum. Kathleen Marikangas did an epidemiological study in adolescents, 13 to 18, 2.2% of the US kids had a bipolar spectrum diagnosis. But look at this, horribly enough, only 22% were in any kind of treatment, psychotherapy, whatever. So we're not getting after this illness early. And then Barbara Geller did a study where she diagnosed these kids with bipolar disorder for sure, and then followed them for 8 years. And a third of them never got any of their right treatments. And those who did get lithium actually had the most time in remission. And that goes along with Daniela Huffman's new data from the Pittsburgh group. When they looked at people, the kids who were on lithium versus atypicals or anticonvulsants, the kids on lithium did much better. Less depression, fewer suicide attempts, all kinds of other things were better on lithium. And the antidepressants are not very effective in bipolar depression in adults, but they're often prescribed. And then the younger the onset of the depression in the kid, it's an increased risk factor for switching into mania on an antidepressant. And here's really disturbing data. Ross Bellandesarini looked at how the first 7,000 7,000 patients with a new diagnosis of bipolar disorder were actually treated. And look at this, 50% with antidepressants and very few percentages with either anticonvulsants, lithium, or atypicals. And there's new data by Andy Nuremberg this past year, which says we don't do it any better now. So this was in 2007 and we haven't learned much. So all of this, either inadequate or delayed treatment, leads to this illness going and progressing faster in the kids as opposed to the adults, more malignant illness. So what do? We can even think about primary prevention with some things that are just okay for, good for you, like a good diet, exercise. Exercise can't be emphasized enough. And if you get exercise that's good for the kid's development, brain development, and then in particular joining a team and having a coach, all kinds of things like that make exercise really important. And it even enhances cognition. Mindfulness can be thought about. There's some very young kids who do mindfulness in general, whether or not they have illness in school, and that turns out to be helpful. Then if there's low risk kids who have just beginning symptoms, secondary prevention, there's all sorts of things we need to see how well these things work. but there's no studies. It's terrible. We need to study all these things, see how well they work. And then we know these things work in adults, and we need to study more of them in kids more systematically so we can develop the best treatment paradigms for the kids who already have full-blown illness. So here's the deal about, if some of you are parents and want to rate your kids age 2 to 12 on these key areas, just anxiety symptoms, mild, moderate, severe, dysfunction, depression, ADHD, oppositional behavior, mania, on a weekly basis, can be done on a secure website from a Johns Hopkins study that we started with Bob Finling. And you can get into this informed consent statement by getting on bipolarnews.org and clicking on the child network. And look at this. This is a kid who was rated every week for a year by his parents. And the meds are up on top, but you can see that whatever meds the patient was on, they weren't working very well because the patient stayed pretty manic-y, quite depressed, much ADHD, and moderate to high levels of anxiety. So if you took this to your doc who's treating your kid, you could say, hey, look, this is no good. We got to change things, okay? So you can help with diagnosis and treatment by helping monitor your kids better. It's like blood pressure. If you know your blood pressure, you can manage it. If you know these symptoms, you can manage it better. Very high risk kids, because of parental, grandparent illness, and maybe childhood adversity, whatever, can definitely do good diet and exercise, family psychoeducation, everybody being on board as to what's going on, coping strategies, cognitive behavior therapy, mindfulness training, mood charting like we showed you, and this family-focused therapy is key. If somebody's starting to get moderately symptomatic any which way, I'd highly recommend that. Family-focused therapy, or it's equivalent to try to get increased family communication. So back to this new thing about treating after a first manic hospitalization intensively, because Lars Kessing in Denmark did this study up here, point one, 2 years of expert specialty clinic treatment that he gave him decreased the amount of relapses, not only over the 2 years, but over the next 4 years as well. So 6 years of doing better with illness education, psychotherapy, drug treatment, mood monitoring, all that stuff. So this was a randomized study, and it tells you if you do it well, you're going to have a better outcome. And here's the other kicker, number two, is why we need to treat it intensively after the first episode, because you lose some cognition after first mania, but it all comes back in the instance that you don't have any further episodes over the course of the next year. Lakshmi Latham in Vancouver has these data, and it's been documented by other groups as well. So treating that first episode big time is the name of the game. And even thinking about lithium for first onset patients is something to think about, because Mike Burke in Australia randomized patients to a year of lithium versus a year of the atypical quetiapine, and every single thing was better at the end of the first year on lithium: mania, depression, functioning, cognition, indices of brain imaging. So here's the thing from Kessing that I mentioned. 2 years of specialty clinic treatment, psychotherapy, medications, illness education. Look what happened after that treatment, intense treatment stopped after 2 years. The next 4 years, patients did much better because they sort of learned how to deal with their illness better, manage it better. So not, you can't prevent all the relapses, but they had a lot fewer relapses than just standard care in Denmark. So we can conclude with that randomized study, early comprehensive intervention and patient education improve the long-term course of illness. And that's a key thing we need to get after. And mood charting of the kid, but mood charting adults is a key issue. This is literally me tearing my hair out because we had a patient who was hospitalized for 10 years in a state hospital and we couldn't figure out how they were actually treated until we did this mood chart and find out what worked and what didn't work. And this patient was ultimately a good responder to carbamazepine. So if you as an adult can map your illness, that'll really help you and your doc get you to remission and keep you that way. So in this illness, we need to find out what really works for you, for an individual patient. Because sometimes what's FDA approved doesn't work. So any guideline is okay if it helps you get to the right place, but if it doesn't work, it's no good. And this leads us to the overview is if you're finding out what works in you, be conservative, stay the course, keep on that regimen and stay well. If it's not working, be more inventive and try to keep on going after things until it does get better. So active changing and people are not responding. So we got a whole bunch of different things to throw at this illness and people who are having troubles and are partially treatment resistant. Lithium there on the left works best in classic bipolar illness with no anxiety or substance abuse comorbidity. Carbamazepine sort of works the opposite in bipolar 2 with anxiety and substance use comorbidity. Valproate is very good for people with comorbid alcohol. And lamotrigine is interesting because it works best in people with a family history of anxiety disorders. So there's some little bits of predictors here that we can use to help choose the initial mood stabilizers for people, because lithium works best in a positive family history of bipolar disorder. Carbamazepine in our hands and in the Canadians' hands work best where there wasn't a family history of bipolar disorder, and there's a lot of people out there without that family history. Lamotrigine, surprisingly, with a personal history or family history of anxiety disorders, and a tip off that atypicals may be needed is if you have a family history of non-response to lithium. Duffy and Aldol in Canada have that being a signal that you need atypicals. So lithium keeps on showing up. And we want to emphasize the assets of lithium. Everybody knows its antimanic efficacy, but lithium actually prevents unipolar bipolar depressions. And you need to tell patients this if you're a doc, or if you're a patient, you need to know that lithium is doing some good things to your brain. It's increasing hippocampal and cortical volume. It increases neuroprotective factors. It actually reduces dementia diagnosis in old age. It has anti-suicide effects. And here's one that I increasingly tell patients when patients say, no, I don't want to take lithium, this is no good. I tell them about the length of their telomeres. Those are the end strands of your DNA, and the shorter your telomeres get, the more illnesses, medical and psychiatric, you get. So lithium increases the length of your telomeres by a direct enzyme effect on telomerase, puts more on there, and you stay healthier. So don't get put off by stories about lithium, including all the negative stories about lithium having problems with creatinine and end-stage kidney illness. It actually turns out that end-stage kidney damage is more common with anticonvulsants than with lithium even. Lithium can cause thyroid dysfunction 10-15%, but it's not a problem because you just treat with thyroid hormone. And lower doses of lithium will avoid most other effects. And I now use lithium at any dose that people don't have side effects. So if you're having lots of side effects on lithium, you're not going to want to take it. So I lower the dose and get the rest of lithium's effects with other things, including a calcium channel blocker that has lithium-like effects. There's lots of things to do here. So what does work if the antidepressants don't? The olanzapine-fluoxetine combination, quetiapine, lurasidone, they work. And there's a new one on the block, cariprazine, which is a dopamine D3 receptor partial agonist, meaning that it stimulates those dopamine receptors a little bit, but prevents them from getting overstimulated. And that works in both mania and depression. And there's a newer one that's not yet approved for bipolar disorder. It's just out there for schizophrenia. And 42 milligrams of Caplyta or lumeprone had very nice antidepressant effects and very few side effects. So there's lots of things out there that we can use in people who have tough to treat illness. Another thing that is nice is that lurasidone is one of these things now that's approved for bipolar depression in kids age 10 to 17. So we have an option and can avoid the antidepressants with something that really does work. And it was very well tolerated, only 2% dropout for side effects. And it had an interesting property that Chuck Raison looked and found that patients, both children and adults, who had a high measure of inflammation, C-reactive protein, they actually did better on this drug. So if you have inflammation, it usually makes response more difficult. This case, it actually made it better. So here we are. If you have a lot of illness, combinations are more effective than monotherapy. Goes across the board. We saw that with lithium and carbamazepine. Lithium and valproate has been shown. If you look there, the second one down, Finling et al. In children, they stabilized kids on the combination of lithium and valproate and then randomized them to either monotherapy to see which one was better than the other. It turns out they were equally bad. Two-thirds of the kids relapsed on switch over to monotherapy, and they all got better back on combination therapy. So for even kids, you need aggressive treatment, multimodal, and the atypicals are generally better with lithium or valproate augmentation. So the combination treatment. And combination treatment is what's necessary in almost all our other medical illnesses. And it's certainly necessary if you fail monotherapy, you got to go somewhere next. And the fourth dot is one that people don't quite get. They say, oh, we'll just have more side effects. But in fact, if you use more drugs judiciously, carefully titrating against side effects, you can actually get fewer side effects than just say pushing lithium to toxicity and tremors and stuff like that. So it's one way to go. Another thing is that we showed you that more than a third of our patients had comorbidities, anxiety, substance abuse, that kind of thing. And we need to treat those too. And it turns out the first two on top there, N-acetylcysteine and acetyl-L-carnitine, you can actually just go out and buy in the health food store. And they have a lot of good aspects to them that I'll mention in a minute. But the other anticonvulsants below, Depakote's FDA approved for mania, but all the other anticonvulsants down there are not effective antimanics, but they have all kinds of good effects in things that are comorbid, like anxiety and social phobia. Gabapentin works in. There's things for bulimia, topiramate, zanisamide, even for cocaine. So over-the-counter meds and off-label meds need to be thought about for this illness. Now, here's this ridiculous thing that you can buy in the health food store, N-acetylcysteine. 500 milligram capsules down at the bottom, twice a day for a week, and then two thereafter. And top left, it works in all kinds of drug addiction, including even helping adolescents avoid marijuana. Helps gambling addiction. It helps habits like trichotillomania and OCD and stereotypy and autism, depression, negative symptoms of schizophrenia. So it does all sorts of fairly nice things. So those of you who are skeptics can rightly ask, how the hell can one drug work in all these different conditions? We don't actually know the answer, but one idea is that N-acetylcysteine pulls out excess glutamate from the synapse. And if glutamate is there, it drives anxiety, depression, bad habits. So getting rid of some of that excess glutamate could be the reason why it's effective in many habits and addictions. There's just a schema that shows that these white dots in the middle are glutamate driving cells too fast. And you can block glutamate release with acetyl-L-carnitine and some of the other drugs. But up there on number two on the top, you can use N-acetylcysteine to get more clearance because you grow these transporters and pull it out of the synapse. There's also something you can do. You can block glutamate NMDA receptors with either ketamine, which works quickly, or memantine, which takes a while to work. But a lot of things can cool off hyperactive glutamate. Okay, so we're coming to the end of the story. What is this acetyl-L-carnitine thing? It turns out that Nasca and other colleagues in New York and California measured acetyl-L-carnitine in the blood of unipolar depressed patients and found that it was low. And people, especially who had early onset, more severe illness, and had a history of childhood adversity. This drug, there's some small studies that it has antidepressant effects. And in animal models of depression, Nasca found out that this drug decreases glutamate release. It helps put in a negative glutamate promoter. And it acts by an epigenetic mechanism. and it works rapidly in a model of depression called defeat stress, where the animal gets repeatedly defeated and doesn't move around, doesn't socialize, that kind of stuff. And antidepressants take 2 weeks to work, but this N-acetylcysteine in that model works in 2 or 3 days. So this is something that we need to figure out more, see if it works, and see if it's helpful in kids with early adversity. So back to psychotherapy. Tons of data here, family-focused therapy, Michelowitz's data in adults and youth at risk. And if you look at the yellow stuff in the middle, he did youth at risk for bipolar. And he found that it had better depression stabilization, decreased recurrence risk, increased psychosocial functioning and quality of life. So Dave Michelowitz at UCLA wouldn't say this, so I have to say it for him. Very high risk children should receive family focused therapy or its equivalent. Your kids having beginning prodromal symptoms, bring in the whole family and have better communication and you'll have better outcomes. So we have a new set of principles. Start prophylactic treatment after the first mania, because be there cognitive deficits will improve only if you have fewer episodes. Treat the comorbidities and residual symptoms to remission. You want to get all better, not just a little better. If you still have residual depression, you're more likely to have a major depression in the future. And then here we are for all of you folks, patients and family members. Learn about this illness as much as you can. Think about staying long-term lifetime treatment to get the illness under control and keep it that way. Psychotherapy, and work on an early warning system to see what you could do if things go off track. And if you're doing well, be conservative, maintain full dose prophylaxis. If you're not doing that well, change things around as aggressively as you can. So if you can moderate the early course of illness, you'll prevent the nasty treatment resistant elements down the line. But even if you have treatment resistant illnesses, there's lots of ways that you can approach it aggressively. So second to last slide here, bipolar depression, relatively treatment resistant. Evidence-based treatments, the ones that really work, use them ahead of the antidepressants, which should be avoided. FALAP means for as long as possible. And you can use more meds and get fewer side effects and better efficacy if you use them carefully. We got to put more lithium in there. It's doing all kinds of good things to brain and body. And we have to knock down the numbers of recurrences because that leads to cognitive dysfunction, treatment resistance, all kinds of bad outcomes. So our new mantra needs to be prevent episodes, protect the brain and body. So that's it. Childhood onset bipolar disorder in the U.S. is common, but poorly recognized, treated, and studied. Early recognition and more comprehensive prophylactic treatment. Kids and adults can convert this early onset illness into a much more benign illness in the future. So there's lots of things we can do to go after it early. And even if we miss that early opportunity, we can treat it aggressively later on. So my takeaway message for everybody is be optimistic, help your patient, help your doctor with mood charting so you can really figure out what's working best for you and then stay with it for the long term when it's working, change it around radically if it's not working as well as you'd like. So we thank you for joining in, and I think we have some time for questions and answers. And again, appreciate all the heroic work you do fighting this illness, and we appreciate the education that the International Bipolar Foundation is providing. That's the name of the game. So time for questions.
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Post. You're the reason that we are able to provide this education to everyone. Thank you so much for sharing all your research. You can submit questions in the chat or the Q&A or in the comment section on Facebook. But our first question comes from Andrea. She said, she's read a great deal of information about misdiagnosis of bipolar disorder in children due to the large numbers of symptoms that overlap with other conditions. What methods did the studies you mentioned use to ensure that there are correct differential diagnoses?
Yeah, the correct differential diagnosis sometimes requires some longitudinal monitoring to really figure out what's going on. But the illness is very highly comorbid with other things, with ADHD that I showed you, but also oppositional defiant disorder is in there. Many different things. Anxiety is often the first thing that shows up, an anxiety disorder comorbidity. So all of these things are mixed in there, and you can't let all of these comorbidities distract you from the main diagnosis of bipolar disorder. So if somebody's really got these bipolar mood swings, the majority of early kids have bipolar not otherwise specified, meaning they don't have prolonged periods of mania for week that's necessary for bipolar one. They have bipolar not otherwise specified, where they can be up and down in a matter of hours. Take that seriously, because the Pittsburgh folks showed that that was very hard to stabilize, even BPNOS. So yes, lots of comorbidities, but look for the key elements of bipolar disorder in the diagnosis.
Awesome. And then she also asked, what do you think of Dr. Mary Fristade's manualized interventions specifically for childhood bipolar disorder, in parentheses, IFP and MF, PG?
Could you say that again? You need to get closer to your mic. I can barely hear you.
Have you ever heard of Dr. Mary Fristade's manual interventions specifically for childhood bipolar disorder?
No, I wish I did.
Okay, no worries. And then we were also wondering, is there any research that you've seen about since ADHD and bipolar disorder have such common symptoms? Have you read any research about how this can be affected by a parent's own mental health conditions, such as if the parent has ADHD or bipolar disorders, does either one of them affect one another?
Yeah, well, if the parent has bipolar, the kids are at risk for a whole bunch of things, including anxiety, depression, bipolar, ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder. All those illnesses are more prevalent if the parent has bipolar. If the parent has ADHD, there's a lot fewer of those. There's more ADHD than you'd predict otherwise. But the ADHD can come with either parent.
Okay, thank you so much. And then another individual from Facebook asks, do you know if cognition declines more for kids after their first manic episode because their brain's still developing?
Those first episode kids were tended to be adolescent or young adults in those studies. And we would hope that the youngest kids whose brains are going like mad and are really plastic would recover completely. And turns out that kids with bipolar illness tend to be really smart and sometimes even geniuses. And the hope would be that with good control, that cognitive function doesn't come off. And if the illness is treated well, patients can be hugely successful in everything. Business, artists, and composers are more represented by bipolar illness people than in the general population. So one can really do well in the long term with this illness, but multiple studies showed that the more episodes you have eventually as an adult, the worse your cognition gets. So it's really important to try to get after the illness well as an adult. Same, I guess, for kids, but I'm not sure about how much cognition they lose or not.
Okay, awesome. And then Gary from Facebook asked, she wanted to first thank you for your great summary. And then she was interested in what you know about the effects on memory. Is it similar to cognition?
Memory and cognition, yeah. The memory test, memory is a big component of the cognitive test they use. And many of these studies in adults, they waited till the patient became euthymic, wasn't manic or wasn't depressed. So it wasn't the illness messing up their cognitive function. And about a third of the patients had pretty much difficult times with these tests. A third were just a little off and a third were fine. So not everybody has the cognitive deficits, but some things you can do is if you do a lot of exercise that helps your cognition. If you're on lithium, it helps protect your cognition. It actually reduces the incidence of a dementia diagnosis in old age. So the big thing is getting after these episodes well and early. But cognition is something that drives poor outcomes and poor quality of life. So you really want to look after it.
Definitely. And then one last question from Dale on Facebook. He was wondering if you had any comments or input on ECTs.
Yeah, I do with ECT. ECTs often good in a medical emergency or somebody with high suicidality or not responding to a whole lot of other things. But when I recommend ECT for people, I tend to recommend right unilateral ultra brief pulse ECT because bilateral can give you some memory defects. Unilateral doesn't have that problem. So if you get unilateral ECT, there's also data from Scandinavia that you can use it for long-term prophylaxis too. So it's a good thing to resort to if some of these other measures don't get you all better. And in terms of the suicide emergency, it works well. And then we also now have IV ketamine working well and quickly. Actually, it can work in one day and it improves both depression and suicidality. But the liability of that one is that it only lasts for about 5 days or a little bit more. So you need repeated injections. But it's another thing to consider when some of these other more traditional things aren't working well enough.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, that's all our time for today. So thank you so much to everyone that joined our webinar. I hope you all enjoyed our conversation with Dr. Post and learned a lot. So let's give him a virtual round of applause. If you would like to learn more, you can visit his site, www.bipolarnews.org, which will be linked in the video description. And you can also visit that site to learn more about rating your child's moods and mental health and join Dr. Post's Childhood Mood Disorders Initiative. Thank you so much, Dr. Post, for sharing your incredible research and insight.
And thank you all for joining in. Appreciate it.
Have a wonderful rest of your day, everyone. Thanks.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.